Let's go, girls.
Hello, and welcome back to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm JC Powers, and every Wednesday, I'm here mixing up cocktails with a her historical twist. So make sure to follow, subscribe, and that way, you're not going to miss a single episode. Today, my friends, I am spilling the tea, the Golden Dynas-Tea, a cocktail that we're going to mix up in honor of one of the most powerful and controversial leaders of the ancient world, Emperor Wu Zetian. To make this cocktail, you are going to need some gin, some vermouth, some turmeric, some sugar, some lemon juice, some ginger, and some water. While you go wrangle all of that up, I am going to start the story of Wu Zetian. Who was Wu? Who was Wu? Wu Zetian was the only woman to ever run over the nation, the Empire of China. There's more than 2,000 years of Chinese history, and only one woman ever wore the golden robes of emperor, which is shocking, but also, you know, still one more woman leader than the U.S. has. Wu Zetian was born in about 625 CE. To give you a worldview, that's when the Mayans were building some, like, dope temples. It's right after the religion of Islam was founded, Muhammad was still alive, the Roman Empire had fallen, so Europe was dark, but things were hopping in China. It was the beginning of the Tang Dynasty, which was widely considered a golden era of culture for China. Did I briefly consider making a Tang cocktail in honor of the Tang Dynasty? Yes, dear viewer, I did. But instead, I decided to lean into an ingredient that is common in Southeast Asian cooking, also common in Chinese medicine, turmeric. We're gonna add a half teaspoon of turmeric to some water alongside 2 tablespoons of sugar. And then we are going to shake it up to make a simple syrup, the simplest of simple syrups, to honor the somewhat simple, humble-ish beginnings of Wu Zetian's life. Wu's family wasn't exactly poor, but they weren't proper nobility either. However, her father was extremely interesting. Wu's father insisted that his daughter be well-educated, well-versed in literature, politics, and music. This was extremely rare for a woman in China in the 7th century, and it was even more rare for this education initiative to be instituted by her father. Her father was also extremely loyal to the emperor, so it's not totally surprising that Wu was given the highest honor available to a woman in China in the 7th century. She was made an imperial concubine. So, cheers to Wu! She was given the prize of getting to bang this dude in his 40s. Every teenage girl's dream. We're gonna add 1.5 ounces of gin to our cocktail shaker. Not because, you know, this is something that we should drink to, but you know, it may be something we need to drink about. So she becomes a concubine, but she wasn't a particularly high-rated concubine. Yes. That is a real thing. The emperor, Taizong, had a tiered ranking system for all of his concubines. 9 tiers, and Wu was like tier 5. She didn't bear him any children. Honestly, she was probably only as high as the 5th tier because she was extremely beautiful. And also, there was this crazy story about her that Taizong loved to tell. Apparently, the emperor went to his concubines and explained that he had this horse that needed breaking and wondered if any of them had thoughts. Wu said that she had some ideas. She said she would need only 3 things in order to break the horse: a steel whip, a steel hammer, and a sharp dagger. She would first whip the horse, and if that didn't work, she would then bash in the horse's head with the hammer, and if that didn't work, she would slit the horse's throat. Couple of things. Thing number one, this is not the way to break a horse. This is the way to murder a horse. But I have to tell you, the nuttiest thing about this story is actually the emperor's reaction. Because Wu says this, and he responds by being like, wow, Wu, you are so brave. What a turn on. And this is just like more proof to my theory that guys always go for the crazy girls. And look, I know that just by saying crazy, it's a derogatory, stigmatizing term that on a Feminist Cocktail Hour, I shouldn't be using. But guys, I mean, she wanted to murder his horse. It's kind of a red flag. Anyway, we're gonna get like Wu. We're gonna get a little bit, I don't know, violent. Probably won't bludgeon a horse, but we'll definitely, you know, mash up some sliced ginger. Pop in two slices of sliced ginger into your cocktail shaker. We're going to muddle that with the gin and with about a quarter ounce of our lemon juice. We are really going to smash it up, just like Wu, not smashing horses, but rather smashing the expectations for your average concubine. See, the emperor died, and traditionally, concubines of the emperor would be sent to a Buddhist monastery where their heads would be shaved and they'd spend their entire lives mourning the death of the emperor. Sometimes the fate was worse than that. Sometimes they were buried alive alongside of the emperor. But in this case, Wu avoided that fate because, plot twist, she was sleeping with Taizong's son, Gaozong, who was now the emperor. So Wu was able to remain in the imperial palace, and because she was a favorite of Gaozong, she rose up quickly in the ranks of concubines. She was a top-tier concubine. In fact, concubine number two, behind a woman commonly referred to as the purest concubine, and of course, Gaozong's actual wife, Empress Wang. Empress Wang was extremely jealous of the purest concubine, Zhao. So she went to Wu and said, hey, let's work together and help sway the emperor's affections away from Zhao. Wu was like, sure, no problem on it. But this plan worked a little too well, and pretty soon the emperor was all about Wu, and she became, you know, the second seed. Well, now Empress Wang is stressed again. She goes to Zhao, figuring she can just spend all of her time pitting these two women against one another and rising above it all. But Empress Wang had no idea who she was fucking with. Wu Zetian had no problem conceiving children, unlike the empress, and had a few sons as well as a daughter. Her daughter died just a few months after she was born. Modern day historians aren't exactly sure why the baby died. It could have been some kind of SIDS related asphyxia. It could have been that Empress Wang murdered the baby because of her jealousy of Wu. That is what Wu Zetian told the emperor. Many historians at the time believed that what actually happened was that Wu murdered her own child in order to frame Empress Wang. And you know what? If that's what happened, the plan was extremely successful because the emperor believed that Empress Wang had killed this baby. He exiled both her and the purest concubine Zhao, who I think was just like kind of an innocent bystander. And ultimately, they were both put to death on Wu's command. The story goes, in fact, that she demanded that they both have their hands and feet removed before drowning them in a vat of wine. That horse murder is looking tame now, isn't it? We are going to add some wine to our cocktail. Not a vat, just an ounce and a half. Our wine is a fortified, aromatized wine, also known as vermouth. So we're going to pop that into our cocktail shaker. Now, at the age of 35, Empress Wu had arrived. Wu had become the Empress Consort and was already immediately given unprecedented advantages and power. For instance, unlike previous empresses, she was able to give offerings to the gods alongside of her husband. She was even attending court with him, albeit behind a screen, but still on a throne of equal height. Wu gained even more power when her husband, the emperor, fell ill. Was she poisoning him? Maybe. That's something that most people seem to believe. And during this time, Wu was making a lot of decisions regarding the government. And by a lot, I mean like she was 100% running the show, guys. She had use of the imperial seal and was just throwing that thing all over the place. She was also like sometimes holding court all by herself. And the emperor was mainly just there to, you know, wave and smile and distract from the fact that a woman was actually in charge. As a note, remember, Wu was incredibly well educated. She had tremendous political acumen, and she was extremely charismatic. Many people felt that she was just a much better leader than her husband. Ultimately, of course, her husband died after 30 years of playing out this dynamic. He died alone, which was very unusual for an emperor. Normally, there would be a huge group of mourners around them. Did Wu kill him? I don't know. She would have no motivation to do so. But it seems really on on brand, and she did kill a lot of people during those 30 years. Wu killed off would-be rival concubines, dissenters. She had an intense police force that killed many of her adversaries. And then she probably killed at least one of her other children. She had a son who she could tell was not going to be the puppet king that she was looking for when her husband died. So she had him killed off. She exiled another son. That meant that it was son number three who eventually came to the throne, with Wu presiding as the Empress Dowager. The Empress Dowager herself did have a fair amount of power. She was able to depose anyone who was emperor who she felt was unworthy of the title. A few months into son number three's reign, and Wu realized that he was not going to be her puppet. He was already the puppet of his own wife. And Wu was like, no, there is only room for one boss bitch in this palace. So son number three was out, and son number four was in. When son number four came into power, Wu just laid it out flat for him. She was like, look, you are not going to do anything. You are not going to make decisions for state. You're not going to meet with government officials. I am going to do all the heavy lifting while you just stay, you know, locked in your room in the palace. This went on for 7 years before finally she said, fuck it. I'm just going to shake things up and run this country myself. Just like we are going to shake up this cocktail. We're going to pop in that ounce of our turmeric simple syrup. Pop on our lid, shake it, and strain into our tea glass. No need for ice for this cocktail because we're going to heat it up in a minute. Let's pour it right into your tea glass. Now, here is the real tea, my friends. It's possible that everything I've just told you is little more than gossip. It won't surprise you to know that, you know, the historians writing about Wu had some issues with her based on demographics alone. The first thing that you might not think of is that the historians of the time were Confucians. And actually, one of Empress Wu's accomplishments was that she was the first leader of China to bring Buddhism to the forefront. For the first time during her reign, Buddhism became the primary religion of the people over Confucianism and Taoism, which incidentally, in the way they were practiced in those days, were more misogynistic than Buddhism. So that was one reason that the historians were not that into Wu. Another reason is that no historian was that into chronicling any of the usurpers. They didn't want the people of China to get the idea that like some random farmer could one day become emperor. And obviously above and beyond all of that was the fact that she was a woman and there was a tremendous amount of discrimination and just like a general double standard. I mean, even the usurping thing. Both of the emperors who she was consort to were usurpers in their own right. They killed off brothers, they killed off cousins in order to make their way to the throne. And, you know, they don't get any shit for that. Also, a lot was written by the historians about, you know, Wu's sexual proclivities, how she had basically this whole harem of men that she was sleeping with while she was empress, which, by the way, like, props to her, because she was 65 years old when she took the throne. So she had like dozens of young men. Good on you, lady. While they threw shade at her, though, obviously no shade was thrown towards the generations of emperors who had stables full of concubines who they, you know, ranked and rotated. Because of the stories of her ruthlessness, many of her accomplishments as empress are totally overlooked. For instance, people focus on how aggressive the secret police were during her early tenure in killing off many people who dissented against her within the government. However, what is being overlooked is that most of these people were highly unqualified. She had them removed from the top tiers of government, you know, by whatever means necessary, but ultimately ended up creating this meritocracy, an examination system for imperial bureaucracy that actually lasted into the 20th century. She also listened to people. And yes, this was partially done by installing mailboxes outside imperial buildings where people could inform on dissenters. But, you know, this complaint box version 1.0 did give the average citizen in China the sense that their voice was being heard in the government, which was a totally novel concept. During the 40 years that Wu was running the show in China, the nation had relative peace. she brought down uprisings and also vastly expanded the borders of the country. Corruption went down while both the economy and the culture of the nation flourished. It was really Wu who helped China become a true power on the international stage. So what I'm saying is, you know, Wu was in many ways a great emperor. That's my hot take to accompany this hot cocktail. We're going to top our cocktail with some hot water. Now, prior to Wu's death, there was this enormous monument, this headstone essentially, that was erected to honor her. This was traditional, that a massive monument would be erected for any emperor who died, and that after their death, their successor would have a lengthy epitaph composed and inscribed on the stone. In 2,000 years of Chinese history, there was only one woman to rule the nation, and there is only one monument that has been left completely blank, which means that it's really up to us to decide what we think of Wu's legacy. And it's also up to us to decide what we think of this cocktail. Let's give it a taste. Oh, it's really nice. I love this. It's fantastic. Turmeric is a very unique, bold flavor. Like Wu, you know, it may not be for everyone. You may try it and not be 100% sure how you feel about it. But the advice I would give to you is, you know, until you can find the words, just keep on drinking. I hope that you enjoyed this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. Make sure to follow, subscribe, and hey, if you had fun, come back next week. I'm going to have a new lady, a new libation. Until then, cheers.
Let's go, girls. Come on.